Good morning. Welcome to church today. Thank you for joining us for this cool October Sunday. It's wonderful to have a little bit of the weather changing. We promise we won't open up the doors and let all that in here, but it feels nice this morning, and thank you for being in your place. If you have your Bibles this morning, I want you to go ahead and take them. We're going to be looking at Psalm 119. Psalm 119. Why don't we stand together this morning, Psalm 119, and Pastor Weston's going to come and lead us.
Good morning. Let's read God's word together. Thou art my portion, O Lord. I have said that I would keep thy words. I entreated thy favor with my whole heart. Be merciful unto me according to thy word. I thought on my ways and turned my feet unto thy testimonies. I made haste and delayed not to keep thy commandments. The bands of the wicked have robbed me, but I have not forgotten thy law. At midnight I will rise to give thanks unto thee because of thy righteous judgments. I am a companion of all them that fear thee and of them that keep thy precepts. The earth, O Lord, is full of thy mercy. Teach me thy statutes. Pastor Jason.
Obviously, you know what's going on around the world. I think it would be not only important, but biblical for us to pray for Israel, to pray for what's going on, pray for their people, pray for those that are in harm's way, not just there in the nation of Israel, but also even around the world, as we're seeing reports this morning. So I ask that you join with me in prayer. David said in God's word in the book of Psalms that we should pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And we know that Jesus said, when they say peace, peace, that destruction comes. And this world is looking for peace, but all we see is violence and destruction. So let's lift up our eyes to the Lord, knowing that He's coming soon, but that He's the only one that can bring peace. Let's ask the Lord this morning to bless. Lord Jesus, we are moved, we are disheartened and discouraged seeing the violence that's going on, not just here at home with what goes on in our nation. Lord, we're saddened by that politically, geographically. But Lord, we also see that in Israel over the last 2 days. And Lord, we ask that you would strengthen their prime minister. You would strengthen their military. You would strengthen their people. Lord, we pray that your people would look to you. Lord, I pray that we as Americans, Lord, we know we've got a rich heritage. We've founded upon certain biblical truths and freedoms and liberties. And Lord, we forget those. So Lord, I pray that you would help your people, Israel, to look to you, cry out to you. And I know certainly this morning millions are. May you be their fortress, their shield, their protector, their high tower. May you, through the strength of that nation, defend their people. Lord, you are the only one who can bring us peace. So Lord, in a troubled world and in a world that is upside down, help us, Lord, not to lose heart and not to lose hope, but to look toward the sky, to be busy while we have breath in our body, to continue to share the good news of the gospel, the only means by which we can have peace in this world. And Lord, even if we don't have peace now in the present, we know one day, Lord, we will be at peace because we'll be at home with you. So Lord, bless your word this morning. Bless your people here today. Bless your nation, Lord, Israel, and bless the service. Lord, may it please you and may it bless your heart. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
We have come into his house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house, and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house, and gathered in his name to worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Christ the Lord.
shackled by a heavy burden, beneath a load of guilt and shame. Then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I am no longer the same. He touched me, oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole. Since I've met this blessed Savior, since he's cleansed and made me whole, I will never cease to praise him. I'll shout it while eternity rolls. He touched me, oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole. Something wonderful happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole.
Amen. Thank you so much for that song, Brother Matt. If I can have four men that would come and grab these handouts for me this morning and make sure everybody has one. If you grab a handout, just as they're passing these out, I do want to, before the message, give a word. And I know many of you have been praying for the family and you plan to be there, but in the passing of Miss Joyce, when we were together last week, she was still here, still struggling, still fighting, but she's with the Lord. Today from 4 to 6 at the funeral home here at Jones Gallagher, there'll be a viewing. The family will be receiving friends. So if you're able to go before service this evening, we encourage you to do so, and please support the family, encourage them. Then tomorrow at 10 o'clock at Lake Swan Camp. So if you've been there, some of you maybe don't know it. Well, maybe you do by the name. It's the Billy Graham Chapel or Center, but it's off to the side where you'd normally eat. There's a chapel that's opened up. That's where the service will be held tomorrow. That's at 11 a.m. And then there'll be a private burial for family. So if you would just not only pray for them, support them. In the email that we have sent out, there is their address. If you'd like to send them a card, flowers, your condolences. I was able to see George, went to visit him on Friday, and was able to talk to him for a little while. And, you know, George and Joyce, I know she didn't build it, but George and Joyce, their family, have meant a lot to our church, as with so many other charter members who were here day one on the ground. And I would be remiss if I didn't, I mean, we're talking about 40 years, 40 days. This series that we've been going through is not based on the fact that we've turned 40. It's just kind of an excuse to say, let's look at what the Bible says about 40. But George and Joyce, they were here when there was no buildings. There were just trees and dirt and critters and just a few people. And so we're very thankful for their testimony. For Brother George, he's a man of few words, but when he does speak, he has something important to say. And pray for him. 70 years of marriage, they've known each other a long time, and kids, grandkids, great grandkids, and no doubt seeing her struggle for 3 years has been challenging. And many of you that know Joy, seeing her in that condition and go down that way, that's, she doesn't stop, much like Brother George. So pray for him, not just over this weekend, but as you all know, once everyone goes home and things get put on the back shelf, just pray for that new normal. It was strange on going over and seeing Brother George sit in, and it was now his chair. He moved it over to where she sat, and then seeing the other chair empty. So for them, for their children, for their entire family, today 4 to 6 at the funeral home, if you can be there before church, and then tomorrow at 11. And if you can't be there, certainly pray for them and send a card. Well, if you have your Bibles this morning, I do want you to go ahead and turn over to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, and Miss Joanne, we'll stay on this slide for a moment until I say that second one, then we'll go, and then so forth. We only have the three. So 1 Peter chapter 2. Now, I've struggled over this message. So in the grand scheme of things, so from when we started our series, you see on your introduction, our church turned 40 on September the 4th. That's officially when our church became a church family. And on that day, we kicked off, or the day before, which was the third on the Sunday, kicked off this series called 40 Years, 40 Days. And we've looked at Bible characters, as you see in your sheet, studying them in situations involving the number 40, Noah and Jonah, Moses, David, the 12 spies. We've been looking at all these different men and their lives and how 40 goes into their story. It's also, I would say, not just to help us relate personally, but on your sheet you can see this is a personal and corporate 40-day journey that helps us, and I hear the words, reflect on the blessings and challenges of our past. So when we hit a milestone as an individual, as a community, as a family, a church family, we can kind of reflect, look at where we are, look back at where we've been, what God's brought us from, remember where God's brought us from, discover His great plan for our future. God, what do you have for us to do? Are we just supposed to live off the blessings of the past, or is this all that there is or was? And then I would say return to God's design for our church as we move forward. And that's kind of the message today. It's kind of right there. And we're going to talk about that this morning. And thus, we're going to look at three icons this morning. In just a moment, we'll talk about that. So 1 Peter chapter 2, I do want to read this to you because this is related to the church. This is Peter talking to what would be a blended church when he wrote this epistle. When we think about the epistles, when we think about the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are Jews, okay? These are sons of Israel. They are well-equipped to know the needs of the people they are called to serve. But Jesus said this in Matthew 28 to them, go into all of Israel, and go into every part of Israel and preach the gospel, but only to Israel. Go only to the people that look like you, talk like you, dress like you, act like you, live close to you. Don't go to that one yet. Don't give it away. Thank you so much. I know you just did, but that's okay. Go back to the previous one. I don't want you to focus on these guys, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You didn't see that. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Okay, you didn't see that. Okay. Jesus said, go to where? All the world and preach the gospel. Go to all the world. Go to every person, every creature. So people that don't talk like you, look like you, dress like you, live where you live. And he gave that command to the church. He gave it to his disciples, and the disciples then who planted churches, started churches, pastored churches, said to the church of which you and I are a part, you go to the world, you preach the gospel. So Peter's talking about this in his epistle. Look at chapter 2, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, if you have your place there. He says, but ye, are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people. So not weird, but you are different. You're unique. You're chosen. You are royal. You are holy. You are peculiar. As a believer, I'm not going to use the term Christian because I think that, but that is a biblical term, but that is somewhat overused in our society today. America is a Christian nation. That's what we say, what we have said. I think we know better. We don't act like a Christian nation. And again, not a message on our nation, but he said here, you are called out. And that's what church is, the ecclesia, the word, meaning you are a called out assembly. You look different, dress different, talk different, come from different places, are different ages, have different gifts. But you are the same in Jesus. You're a called out assembly. Look at the verse. What's our purpose? That you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. So we don't go around beating our chest over the fact that we're Baptist or we're Southern Independent Baptist, because we're not Southern Baptist, but that we're Southern Independent Baptist. We don't beat our, look at us, we're Baptist, and that's what we proclaim. B-A-P-T-I-S-T. Baptist, Baptist, Baptist. Go, go, go. Fight, fight, fight. No. What did he say? What's our purpose? Our purpose here is to show the praises of God. God, not the Baptist, and not the Catholics, and not the Pentecostals, and not whoever it might be, they are not the ones that have saved us and pulled us out of darkness into light. Verse 10, which in time past we were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. So Peter's writing to a blended church of Jews and Gentiles, some that are still confused about the law and what do we have to do? Some in the church, they were saved. If they're in the church, they're saved, because to be a member of a church, to be a member of God's family, you have to be personally adopted into the family of God. You're saved by the grace of God because you have received the gift of God, but you're also baptized publicly into that family, and there's something that is different about you. So Peter's writing to people in the church that some are, you know, as Peter even was confused, I won't eat pork, I won't eat lobster, I won't eat shrimp, I won't eat bacon, I won't eat, and remember the Lord showing him the big blanket, picnic blanket of all the food, and he says, rise and eat. I can't do that, I'll follow the law. Well, he did it again, rise and eat, Peter. I can't do that, that's unclean, I follow the law. Rise and eat, Peter. Lord, I've never touched this stuff, and I don't plan to do it now. By that time, basically, God sent someone by to say, you need to go speak to someone who is unclean, someone who is outside of the boundaries of Israel, someone that's a Gentile. And that whole dynamic of the church as Christ came to seek and save the lost, he gave that commission to the church to preach the gospel, to go to every creature, to be a transformed group that is taking the life-changing gospel message to people that need to hear it. There's no church that is perfect, but a church that refuses to do what God's called them to do is anathema. They are not living out the decree of God. So as we discover God's plan, we return to God's design, we reflect on God's blessings, and we remember where God's brought us from. Look at your sheet. How can we do this? How can we really discover what God has for us, as Peter's writing? Well, I would say by personal and corporate self-examination, we have to look at ourselves. You know, we're not going to become a better, and I don't want to say better in the sense of we're a better team than, you know, you can look at the rankings today and see the point spread of teams that won or lost, and then they will get kind of filtered into the rankings based on the spread of the points, who they played, if they won or if they lost. We don't do that with church. Maybe some people think of it that way, but that's not how we do it. So how do we self-examine individually? You have to, in this, what we're doing today, I'm going to ask you to do that. I can't do that for you, nor you for me. But we have to do that as a church family. Lord, where am I at? And where am I going? What am I doing with what you've given me? So here are three questions. Ask yourself, as a believer, what is my relationship with God's Word? What is your relationship with God's Word? If you're a believer, and which is another word for Christian, Christ follower, if you're a follower of Jesus, you're a believer, you've been saved, what is your relationship with the Bible? Do you have your Bible this morning? One reason it's good to have an actual copy, not saying that you can't use your tablet, which I have here in front of me and my Bible, but this won't talk back to me and it won't distract me. And if I'm looking at it, it's not going to ding at me. I won't be interrupted if I'm looking at it. I mean, it's just my mind I have to deal with, and that's a big problem sometimes. But God's Word, what is my relationship with this book if I'm a believer? Number two, ask yourself, as a believer, is my life pure, and am I being led by the Holy Spirit? So the Bible, of which Jesus said, I am the living Word. Jesus said, I am the Word. So Jesus is the Word. He's given us His Word, and He has left for us His Holy Spirit. What is my relationship to the Holy Spirit? I'm not going all crazy on you here, but as Baptists, we believe in the Holy Spirit. And in fact, if you're a believer, you have the Holy Spirit indwelling you. So what is your relationship? Because the Holy Spirit is going to lead you, as we're going to see in just a moment, into the truth. And He is going to be someone that is going to help you to live a pure life. He's the one that guides you into truth and guides you into clean living. And what is my relationship to Him? Do I have to put that on pause when I'm with certain friends? Do I have to close my Bible when I know I'm going to certain activities? Do I have to ask, you know, I don't want you looking over my shoulder because I'm going to do this or that. And then number three, ask yourself, as a believer, is my relationship with the church, His church, where it should be? So where are you in your relationship to the church? You know, this is what Paul writes to the church of Corinth, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 and 20. Says, you are the temple of God. You are the church. You, individually, me. If I'm a believer, I'm a part of the church. Romans chapter 12 says that the head won't say to the foot, nor the eye to the ear, or the nose to the stomach, I don't need you. Man, we need every part of us. And so the church is comprised of, as Peter learned, of different pieces, but they all combine into one body, and Jesus Christ is the head of the church. So what is your relationship to the church? Where are you at? And you say, well, what are you driving at? So look at your sheet. As I think about and have thought about for weeks, God's design for our church and our need to, I would say, rediscover His great plan, I ask, how can we do this? And this is where I recall some childhood memories. So now let's go to the slide, Miss Joanne. And that we flashed up. Miss Joanne, if we can go to that slide. So when I think of my childhood, there were three icons. Well, I say icons. There were three characters. You see, that two of which I saw every Saturday morning. And some of you, if you don't know, at least if you don't know these people, then we'll talk afterwards. But there are three people, and I have it on your sheet for you. So if you have a sheet, I want you to take out your pen. And when you think of the first guy here, I've given you the name, but some of you didn't even need me to give it to you. His name is Bill Dance. Outdoors. I mean, the guy would show you every Saturday afternoon. He was on TV when I was a kid about fishing. And then, of course, for me, there was Indiana Jones. Wasn't so much, I was a kid, I mean, when he first came on the silver screen, but Indiana Jones. And then, of course, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. Can't even do it, but Dusty Rhodes, he was a wrestler. Why am I illustrating it this way? Well, look at your sheet here. When you think of Bill Dance, you think of first blank fishing. Maybe you think of different things. Some of you might think of Tennessee because he's a volunteer. He's always wearing his Tennessee hat. I know Pastor West is happy about that. But fishing, he's always fishing. When you think of Indiana Jones, I think of the bullwhip. And as a kid, oh my goodness, I mean, he had this, you can see it, he's holding his hand. He always had it. And I always wanted to, you know, he could do it on the tree and he could swing on it. That doesn't work. My dad, I remember we would go up to Cherokee every year in Maggie Valley, ghost town in the sky as kids. we go up there, and one year he got me the guns, but one year I got, he had a whip that he had gotten there, and it was a kind of whip that you would expect to get when you just buy it at a five and dime. It didn't work. You could wrap it around a tree. Don't try to swing on it, because if you do, you know what's going to happen. You're going to be on your back. But when Indiana Jones did it, he could swing over a gorge. There are spikes at the bottom and certain death. But the bull whip is what I think of. And Dusty Rhodes, when I think of Dusty Rhodes, I think of an elbow. I mean, it was almost comical, but I mean, this guy would, you know, he would just give you over here, and he'd go over here and just doing all this. Why am I sharing this? Well, look at the blank number two, the descriptive term. I think of Bill Dance. I think of a hook with Indiana, with a whip, with Dusty Rhodes, wrestling or wrestle. So what about with the church? When it comes to the time of talking about the things that matter most, and especially as we partake of and forth tell the Word of God to Christians. Number three, when I think of Bill Dance, there's bait, okay? Indiana Jones, you know, if it's the whip, I mean, you're kind of scared of that thing. I mean, it's going to hurt. And then number three with Dusty, basically, you're going to be beaten into submission. I mean, it's going to be submit or beat. And I'm saying this here, the fish on the hook, the whip in the hand, the elbow to the head. As we approach church so often, and in particular this message, I want you to know that I'm not coming at you with a hook, you know, I'm not Bill Dance. Okay, let's put some bait on here. Let's kind of get them. You know, but that does that happen in church at times with religious groups? Certainly. What about, let's crack the whip on these people. Oh my goodness, these people. And does that happen in church? No. How about you feel like you've been wrestled into submission? You're going to do this. I'm going to drag you down here, bless God. It's either driving them or dragging them. And I'm going to give you one for in Jesus' name. Pin them, figure four. Okay, one, two, three. And count them out. But can I just say, maybe some of those are your similar childhood memories, but I would say we need to have an open conversation today. This is why I wanted to kind of lead into this. And the open conversation begins with an open Bible, open eyes and ears, hands and hearts, and I don't need a hook, a whip, or an elbow, the bionic elbow from the American Dream. I don't need that. As we're going to see, we shouldn't have to guilt, to wrestle, to drag, to push, to pull believers. That's not really, I think we all grew up in certain ways, but maybe that's the truth. I believe will have a different effect on people the way it's presented. But the truth of God's word, in fact, it says, Jesus said, my word will not return void, meaning when the word of God goes out, it has an effect on people. It really does. And so notice your sheet. The presentation of biblical truth will be felt in different ways. Let me give you two instances here. The truth hurts, or truth hurts when it hits close to home. I've heard it said before, that hard preaching, I tell you what, it stepped on my toes, or it blessed my heart. Whatever the case might be. Some people are like, just give it to me hard, preacher, let me have it. Some are like, you know what? Boy, Jonathan Edwards just read his sermon, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, and people were gripping the pews thinking hell itself would open up and swallow them in because of the conviction that was on them from the Word of God, the reverence for God, and because of the power of the Holy Ghost that was evident in the truth of God that was being presented to the people who were obviously not where they should be. So, bam, bam, you know, whatever people may think about church, those methods are often used in church work and in preaching or in getting people. And I'll say this, that's not my intent this morning, nor is that our intent any morning. That's not our intent. But when the truth is presented as it is going to be, and you're going to read this, it might feel like a bionic elbow to the head. It may feel like there's a whip being cracked. It may feel like that, but as I'm going to direct us to the Word of God, I pray that it points us back to Scripture, to Christ, and not to a man or to images of a bad experience that we've all had. Well, we've all had bad experiences in church, but and even in our walk with the Lord. But I'm going to direct us back to, as I've had to go back to the Word of God, and not to people, not to denominations, not to experiences, not to those things of being hooked, to being whipped, to being wrestled down. You're going to do this. 15 verses of Just As I Am is as much a bionic elbow as I've ever seen it. You will get down to this altar, and if it's the last thing that I do, and you're still sitting there. You will surrender to Jesus, and here's how we're going to do it. Let's bait that hook and throw it out. Now, I've spent a lot of time there, but let me give you this on your sheet. I believe we've been, and you keep that there, we've been given, believers, the three most wonderful gifts in the world. What are these gifts? Of course, Jesus is the gift. He gives us the gift of salvation. Jesus is the Word. I'm not discounting Jesus at all, because He is on our lips. He's ever present in our lives. But we've been given the three most wonderful gifts in the world. I've listed them for you on your sheet. Number one, the Word of God. Number two, the Holy Spirit. Number three, the church. This is biblical. These are, I love my kids. I love my wife. I love where I live. I love my health. I love living in America. They are gifts, but they're not the three most wonderful gifts in this world that were given to humanity. The Word of God, which is eternal, the psalmist said, "Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven." This will never change, and it is the Word of God. It is God's Word. So I can base my life, build my life, and center my life on what it says. I don't have to doubt it, even though I have questions. God is not afraid of honest questions when we come to Him. But the Word of God is, as we're going to see, a gift, the Holy Spirit and the church. Note on your sheet here, I've given you just a couple of descriptions about the Word of God. God's Word, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. You know what this says? The Word of God is quick, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. It says that it divides, it pierces to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints of the marrow and the discerner of thoughts and intents of the heart. The Word of God is like a scalpel. That's what the word is, a sword. It's a surgeon's scalpel that when the Word of God is read, it is preached, it is taught, it is received, it's a scalpel that cuts right to the heart. You ever been cut to the heart by what someone has said about you? Or someone has lied or hurt you, or they have done something or insulted you, and it cut, oh man, you cut me deep. We say that term, it cut me deep. That hurts. Well, the Word of God will cut us deeply, but not to hurt us, but to heal us. It's like a surgeon saying, you've got something in your life that the Word of God has discerned, and you know it, and I know it. No one else may know it, but the Word of God can cut right to the heart and say, you need to deal with this. No one else might know what you're dealing with, but the Word of God, which is a gift from God that He's given you, that every person has on this or in right here, physical form, in the page. What is your relationship to the Word of God? God's Word is a sharp sword. Look at the second point. God's Word tells me who God is, who I am, how much He loves me. God's Word guides me in the right direction, teaches me how to live. God's Word corrects me with truth and love and reveals grace and mercy. God's Word tells me everything I need to know. Some people don't believe this book is completed. Some people believe this book is filled with errors. Some people believe the book is still being written today, a la all of these many charismatics who some of them say that it's open-ended revelation and it's whatever you believe and dream and perceive. The Word of God is final. There is a closing page, and in the beginning, God. It starts there, God. It begins with God, it ends with God. And all in between, I find the plan for my life. So my relationship to the Bible is very important. And each of these three gifts are all tied together. You can't separate them. So what is my relationship with the Bible? Ask yourself, what is my relationship with the Bible? Do you, in essence, Do you have to rub your finger across because of the dust that's on it? Because it's been so long, maybe not physical dust, but it's been so long since you've actually read the Bible yourself, other than in church, you personally, as a believer. Secondly, this is in John 14. The second gift is the Holy Spirit. Well, what about the Holy Spirit? Who is the Holy Spirit? Well, John 14, this is Jesus saying, Jesus speaking. Jesus said here, if you love me, keep my commandments. I will pray the Father. He'll give you another comforter. This is the Holy Spirit. He will abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive. It seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him. He dwelleth in you and shall be with you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Jesus in John 14 says the comforter is the Holy Ghost that you have if you're a believer. So what does the Holy Ghost do? The Holy Spirit. Look on your sheet. The Holy Spirit always points me to Jesus. He always points me to Jesus. And in fact, Jesus talks about that. He doesn't speak of himself. He speaks about me. The Holy Spirit always leads me to biblical truth. The Holy Spirit always points me to Jesus. The Holy Spirit always points me back to the Bible. This is what you need to do. Not roll around on the ground and bark like a dog. Not foam at the mouth and act like a fool. Not, well, this is what I think I should do because I've been led to do that. Well, okay, what is that that you're led to do? Okay, I see that. Now, is there a chapter and verse for that? Because that looks like it violates this. And this is what God's given us. You just want to do what you want to do. This is what God said to do. So the Holy Spirit will direct us back to the Scripture. The Holy Spirit always convicts my heart. Do you feel that conviction from the Holy Spirit because of what you have read in Scripture, because of what He has led you to read, what you have heard, which may feel like a pounding, which may feel like a whoosh, which may feel like, oh my goodness, this is hard. And of course, even Moses, we've learned, Moses said to God himself, I can't do this. I'm afraid. I can't even speak. This is hard. And God says, I'll be with you. I'll be with you. I'll give you Aaron to go with you. I'll be with you. I'll give you the words. You just go and you tell them. Well, the Holy Spirit convicts my heart and the Holy Spirit empowers me to live holy. The Holy Spirit helps me to do what this book says I can do. I can do all things through Christ, which it's talking about in context. It's dealing with how I give to the Lord of my time, of my energy, my resources. But in essence, and generally speaking, because of Christ and because of the Holy Spirit that He has left me, I don't have to be afraid. The Holy Spirit brings me comfort when I can't be comforted any other way. When drugs can't do it, friends can't do it, vacation can't do it, hobbies can't do it, when TV shows can't do it, football games can't do it, when all these things can't do it, recreation can't do it, the Holy Spirit brings me comfort. He helps me to live holy. So, what is your relationship with the Holy Spirit right now? As a believer, what is your relationship with the Holy Spirit? What is it? And then finally, what is your relationship with the church? And we read 1 Peter chapter 2. I've already quoted for you Romans chapter 12. We won't take time to turn there. What is your relationship with the church? So let's go to the next slide and let's turn over our sheet. And this is what I gave you at the start of the 40 days. You had this, and this was what we had asked, other than at the very beginning, and I've listed it for you, not only on the screen, which you'll see, but here in front of you. So on the top here, what is my relationship to these three wonderful gifts? Personal inventory. I want you to ask yourself right now where you are with the pen, with your paper, with your Bible, with your device. As a believer, here's a question. Can I live without God's Word? Can I live without God's Word? Next week, we're going to see Jesus fasting for 40 days in the wilderness, and then we're going to see how He ended His ministry, how He began His ministry, how He ended His ministry, and they both have to do with 40. But can I live without God's Word as a Christian, as a believer? Kind of rhetorical, but practically speaking, there are many that try and do, and it'd be like me saying I'm married but not going home. You know, I love the Lord, but I don't need this. Just don't. Second question, as a believer, can I live without the Holy Spirit? Again, rhetorical question. No, of course not. If you're a believer, you belong to God. He belongs to you. You're brought into the family. Number three, as a believer, can I live without the church? Can I live without the church? And again, I would say it's just seemingly not that important to many Christians as it relates to these things. The Word, the Spirit, the church. Not the hook, not the whip, and not the elbow. This is the truth of God's Word. So, on September the 4th, we encouraged everyone to commit to 5 Bible truths. So, 41 days ago is what we did, 41 days ago, because yesterday was the 40 days, to commit to 5 Bible truths over the course of these 40 days. And there they are on the screen, which is to pray for your church, connect with your church, invite someone to church, support your church, participate in your church. Now, what is your relationship to God's Word? You say, well, I'm good. Okay, you're good. We're not perfect, but I'm going to do what the Bible says to do. Okay, good. And your relationship with the Holy Spirit, well, I'm trying to live a pure life based on what God's Word says. And He convicts me when I'm wrong. He points me back to Scripture, reminds me of Jesus, and He helps me to live holy. So the Word of God is my God. The Holy Spirit's keeping me on the path. And, well, what's your relationship with the church? Well, you know what? If I'm not busy, if it's not going to inconvenience me, if it's not at the bottom of my list, I'll try to move it up. And it's just sad that that's the case with so many believers. Thus, why I'm not leading with dragging, pushing, pulling, whipping, hooking, elbowing. The Word of God has to speak through the Holy Spirit and through His Word. Let His Word through His Spirit have His work in your heart. And this is not a message for people who aren't here, because if they aren't here, then they aren't here. I'll preach it again next week if I have to. But it's a message for those who are here. And you are here and I are here. And we need it, don't we? Amen. We need it. I need it. So we've already looked at pray for your church. So let me just list it for you. Pray for your church. We saw that in Ephesians 6:18. We prayed that we would be spiritually hungry, we'd be thankful, we'd be holy, united, and growing, that we would be a church that just loves God's Word. And really, Jesus said, and Job even said it, your Word is food to me. This is it, not our picnics or our fellowships or our activities or even the little things that are good that we do, but it's the Word of God. Everything that we do should be centered on and based upon the Word of God. So ask yourself, am I praying for my church? And what is my prayer for our church? What is your prayer for your church? What is your prayer? You know, we all pray for different things, don't we? And kids pray for different things. Oh, I want to go to Disney World, and I want to be, you know, whatever. And then as we get older, I want to go to Disney. No, we don't say that, but maybe we pray for all kinds of different things. What is your prayer for the body of Christ, for the church where you worship? Lord, help people who don't look like me to show up to the church where I attend, where I'm a part of. Help people to know who you are, to love your Word. Help us, Lord, as we've said, to be thankful and not to be ungrateful, to be united and not divided, to be centered on your will and not on just schemes that we want to do. Two, connect with your church. Connect with your church. You know this verse, Hebrews chapter 10. I've listed the verses for you here. Hebrews chapter 10 simply says, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is. And that is a command from Scripture that says, you need to be in church. That's what it says. That's not Indiana Jones snapping at your backside. That's the Holy Spirit and Jesus Himself saying you need to be here. So look at it. When the doors are open, this is what my daddy used to say to me, I should be there. When the door is open, I should be in church. Now, it's okay. Miss Penny talked about roaches and all that. She didn't mention crickets, but I do hear some crickets. But that's okay. You're here, and that's what's important. It's not for anybody else outside of here. This is for us. When the doors are open, I should be here. We should be here in church. The Bible commands it. It's where I grow and I connect with the Lord. And I need to prioritize my relationship. You don't have to think about going to work tomorrow, do you? Or going home for supper if you're married, if you're a kid, and you're like, well, you know, I think I'll just stay out for 3 days. Well, your parents are going to have a problem with that. Your siblings might be okay with that. Good, I got their room. Okay, great. I always wanted that TV or whatever. But when it comes to the Lord's church, it's like not even on the list. Well, if we can make it, fine. If we can't, we'll be there when we're there. That's not scriptural. That's not biblical. And if my relationship to God's Word, to His Holy Spirit, are where it should be, my relationship to His church, the bride, will be where it needs to be. Do you know when we meet, where we meet, and why we meet? I would encourage you to know those things. Why do we meet? It's not to look at us, the Baptist brethren, you know, we're like the four horsemen. I mean, to use the, you know, well, look at us, we're great. No, we don't meet to pat ourselves on the back. Whoa, great are we, or woe is us. We don't have a bunker underneath the church that we're preparing for Armageddon, nor are we going out to mountaintops, if you can find one in Florida, to say, even so, come Lord Jesus. We want to be busy for the Lord's work, doing what He's called us to do, but we can't be busy if we're not even present, if we're not even here. Connecting to each other like we're family and to those who visit. I miss my grandparents tremendously, and I miss connecting with them a ton. And some of you are very blessed because your family lives right here. My grandparents have been gone for many years. But when I would go to their house with all the cousins, it wasn't awkward and weird that I was around old people. And for me as a kid, I mean, there were some awkward moments, of course, you always have that. But in the church is comprised not of just old people. Why did I point to the stage where I'm standing? Old people, it's comprised of every generation. That's the church. The church is not one that just gears itself to, we're a young adult church. We only want teenagers and young people, so we're going to be hip with it. Yo, let's go. I don't even know if they say that these days, but that's how it came out. No, we're young. No, we're old. We're this. Your family's not like that. The church is not supposed to be like that. I'm not afraid of old people because kind of I are one, and I'm not afraid of young people because I have them. We are a family, so connect, even if it's awkward, to those who visit even. Ask yourself, am I trying to connect or am I kind of running from this and seeking isolation? You know, this way, that the only danger often of a building that is larger are people with busy schedules and all this. The time that we often connect is on Sunday, and there's, for some, there hasn't been an opportunity to connect in weeks, dare I say for some, in months. Because church is just not that big of a deal for some. 3, invite someone to come to church. 1 Peter 3:15. Maybe I've quoted Matthew 28. Go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature, go. But 1 Peter 3:15, he says that you need to be ready. We should be ready to give an answer to every person that asks me a reason of the hope that lies within me. Why do you cheer for the Tar Heels? Well, I'll tell you what, when I was a kid, I could tell you. Why do you like to go fishing? Or why do you like to, boy, I could tell you these places, these things. Why do you love your wife? Oh my goodness, I'll tell you how we met, when I first saw her, when we got married, the memories we've made. I could tell you all that. Well, have you told someone about Jesus? Have you, and here's the good thing. We are partners in this. That's what I loved about, let's go back to the wrestling. Bill Dance made it look good too. Not that he wrestled, but he would wrestle with those bass out there. But the bloopers, now you can see the bloopers, but he would have to wrestle that thing, but when you have in wrestling, you've got a tag team, you got a friend over here in the corner, you can go over, and we're tag team partners. Did you know that? I don't know if I want to be Dusty Rhodes or not, but I'm one of those guys. I'm with you. And what does that mean? I can, and you can, invite someone to church, even if you don't know the words to say. Would you come to church with me? Because I will be there with my family and my Bible. Would you come to church with me? And if you do your part, and you tag, you can be confident that with God's help, we are going to teach the Word of God in the way that we know it best, just to say, here's the truth. And we're not going to hook them, whip them, or elbow anybody in the head. That's not what we do. So we are partners. So ask yourself, have I invited someone to church or even talked to someone about Jesus? Like, oh my goodness, this is getting, you're climbing the top ropes, Pastor. I mean, this is not like the ladder, the cages, the tables, the chairs. What are you doing? This is getting ugly. Well, I want to encourage you. It's been on my heart. It's just been on my heart that as a church family, that we hone in on things that truly matter, that are eternal. Final 2:4-5. Support your church. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, you know this verse. If you want to turn there, I've got this last verse here, two last verses, 2 Corinthians 9. Support your church by faithful giving. And this is giving of your time, giving of your money. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. But this I say, he or she which soweth sparingly, they give little, shall reap sparingly. He that soweth bountifully shall reap bountifully. Every man, every person, according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity. There's that Bill Dance, Indiana Jones, Dusty Rhodes. He's right there in that verse in the Greek. That's what it says. It says Dusty Rhodes. Nor of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. So here's the blanks here. In fact, I don't think I gave you all the blanks there. Under invite someone, it's a personal choice. It's a personal choice. Under number 4, we don't give until it hurts because of a hook, a whip, or an elbow. Almost probably to my detriment as a pastor, as a minister, whatever you want to call it, that some people would say, you know, we don't, okay, thermometers here, fundraisers there, make sure everyone has a box of envelopes, and let's have ATMs outside. We'll have them actually in the parking lot, because in order to park here, you got to put your tithe in the parking meter, and then that way you can park it. Well, I'll just go down the street. Well, we've worked with them too, and they're going to have it there. To my detriment, we don't major on this, because as a believer that knows God's word, we don't give until it hurts. We know that God loves a cheerful giver. What does that mean? That giving to the Lord is my duty. I do that with a full heart. I give him. The Bible talks about our hearts, our treasure, our tithe, and grace giving. I'm not going to give you a whole message on tithing and grace giving, but I say it every Sunday, and I would say it to you personally, and many of you I have, and corporately. You need to pray about what God would have you to give. But it's a cry and shame that we spend more on our phones, our internet, our entertainment than we even do at church, supporting the finances, the ministries, the missionaries of the church. It's a shame. And I say that to our detriment as a church. It's not right. It should not be. Giving is an investment of my time and my effort. You know, they say this, and I've heard this quote, when a businessman or businesswoman is on their deathbed, they'll never say, I wish I had made more money. They would say, as the saying goes, I wish I had spent more time with my kids or with my family or with people who care. You know, when I go home to play football or Legos or whatever it is, I'm not really good at that, or watch movies, go to the beach, do whatever with my family. It's not, oh, come on the clock, let's go, got to get back to. It's an investment. This is the gift that God gave me. When I'm with my church family, it's an investment. Not like, okay, I'm doing something, I'll scratch your back so you scratch mine. No, we're not going Enron, that kind of stuff. We're not some Ponzi scheme. It's here, according to Scripture, Paul writes it, you give to the Lord wholeheartedly, cheerfully, not sparingly. I'm all in, they said at camp. I'm all in. And if you're all in, you're willing to invest your time. I'm here to help, whatever it is. So ask yourself, am I faithful to tithe, to give to missions? You know, we have missionaries, and maybe because our church, I just want to throw this in here real quick. Our church doesn't, percentage-wise, divvy up missions based on our tithes and offerings. I know many of you know that. I just want to remind you of that. So if you give money, I have some this morning here to give, but if you give money this morning, and let's say you give $10 to the tithe or general fund, whatever it might be, we don't take a percentage of that and then, okay, so we're going to take 10% of that and give it to missions based on what you gave. If you give the missions, it's because you said, I'm giving to missions, and that's how we do it. We give to missions. based on what people here in the church give. And many of you do that. Thank you. Praise the Lord for that. There are men and women on the field today still sustained because of the intentionality, the cheerfulness, on purpose giving of many. I'm still here because of that. And there are many wonderful men and people in ministry that are bivocational. Wonderful. All of us, wherever we are, whatever we do, we should be all in investing in the Lord's work. So ask yourself, have I prayed about what I should give? Have I prayed about it? Have I planned to do it? Am I investing my time in God's work? Well, I want to say with some of the men and women that are here, I'm thankful for them. And through the years, it could be just setting up food in the fellowship hall for many years. The lawn and the grass and the trees and even still working, cleaning the buildings, just being out there to greet someone in the foyer, making a call, making a visit, writing a card, the smallest things that we don't see is an investment that God sees. God sees that. Finally, number five, participate in your church. And here's where we close. This is Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4, and he gave some apostles, Ephesians 4, some prophets, evangelists, some pastors, teachers. Why did God give pastors, teachers, evangelists, missionaries, these leaders to the church? Why is that? He says it in verse 12, for the perfecting, the maturing of the saints, for the work of the ministry, the edifying, the building up of the body of Christ, the church. Why? Until we all come in the unity of the faith, we come where we need to be, the knowledge of the Son of God, Jesus, unto a perfect man, a mature person, the measure of the stature, the fullness of Christ. Our goal is to be like, look like, act like, think like Jesus. And sometimes it can be frustrating because, you know, clean your room, kids. I mean, spiritually speaking. Don't you think that, I mean, I tell you, we have to clean our rooms too. We're not up here, well, we have to personally get along with God to say this is it. In fact, this week, early on, Tuesday, we as a pastoral staff spent time talking about this, praying for Sunday, for you, for our church, for those watching at home, because I'm burdened, extremely burdened about this. That it's just like, whatever. It can seem to be that way, that church just doesn't seem to be the Word of God or even maybe living it. So when I am present and connected, I will be in a position to serve. I'll put myself in a place where I have that opportunity to serve. I can't serve and participate if I'm not even there. It doesn't work. I listened to a lot of interviews yesterday, one of which was some old guy that played for Oklahoma front line back in the day. And he says, in these games that we lost against Texas, he says, you know what happened? We came in injury free. And then one of our the center guy went down. And because he went down, and then a red shirt freshman that had never started came into the game. And he says, in just that one position, because our senior starting center had gotten injured, it changed the dynamic of the game. He says, I'm not making excuses, but he said, that one piece out really changed the trajectory of the game. When you're not here, you know, we need you. In fact, this is where you're supposed to be if you're a believer. And it's Sunday, it's the Lord's day. The Lord's day. You need to be in the Lord's house. There are opportunities to participate and serve. I would say, seek them, ask about them. Two final questions. Ask yourself, where am I involved in serving in the church? Ask right now to yourself, where am I involved right now in serving? Where? Well, I just don't. You might not be able to serve like someone else. I'm not saying singing a solo, playing a guitar, playing the piano, speaking, teaching, but where? Where are you involved in some way in the ministry? Ministry meaning of service, of helping, of just being present. And if not, why not? If you're not, where are you? Final question, ask the pastoral leadership. I welcome that. I'm not on the top ropes jumping down. I'm not doing that. Not Nacho Libre or our Dusty Roads here. None of those things. What are the needs at our church? Where can I be involved? What can I do? And I think that's, I'm encouraged because over the life of our church for 40 years, when I look at that building next door, when I go through the building, when I think of it, I think of 40-some-year-old men, Brother DeWitt, is that what it was, about 40-year-old men and their wives and their teenage kids here, right, Brother Giz, on this property that came here. And as with many churches where they go and start a church because the Lord has put it on their heart, it's a collection of people that are not perfect people, but they, when I think of that, they said, what can I do? When I walk through that building, and on Wednesday nights as we prepare for Awana, I'm walking around turning lights on outside. I'm walking around, and I think so often about, I look at the grass, I look at the court, I look at the building, I walk through the buildings, I turn the lights on, and I'm looking around, and I'm like, you know, God has given us some of the greatest people on the planet here at our church. They've built this with their bare hands, other than this building, and even much in this building was built by people in this room that you love the Lord. I'm so thankful for you. We are on the same team. This is not, Indiana Jones versus the Nazis here. This is not Bill Dance and Every Fish in the Lake or Dusty Rhodes and whoever he's facing with the bionic elbow. We're on the same team. And one day, thank the Lord, we are going to be in heaven together, and where the Word of God is settled, the Holy Spirit is present, and the church will be with the Lord, absent from the body, present with the Lord. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, as the closing verses say of the Scriptures. I am so thankful every time I get together with the church. I want to be here. I need to be here. I'm going to be here. That's something you have to ask yourself. So are these three gifts at the closing of your sheet, are they important to you? Are they important to me? What is my belief? Well, I believe this. Well, do I behave in that way? I believe it. Do I behave that way? We know the truth, but are we willing to live it? It begins with a choice if you're a believer. I'm going to, as the song says, I have decided to follow Jesus. Okay, well, what does that mean? I'm going to live by what the book says. I'm going to be led by the Spirit. I'm going to try to live holy, even though it's hard. And I'm going to be around people that want to help me because I'm supposed to be there. Can we say that? Can we say that as believers? Let me encourage you. Not hooking you, whipping you, or elbowing you. I'm trying to encourage you through the Word, through the Spirit, and based on the Scriptures in the church. Let's do this together. Let's pray.